Welcome to Buffoon of the Week, where we review the past week's news and current events and search for newsmakers who said or did something so dumb that they earn the kind of recognition that they probably don't want. We nominate them for our dubious distinction, and then you vote for who you think was the bigger buffoon by either clicking on the I in the top right corner of the video or by leaving a comment below in favor of your choice. In what can only be termed as a monumental upset, you voted CNN's Brian Stelter as Buffoon of the Week over kooky conspiracy theorist Alex Jones by one freaking vote. All I can say is, wow. Some comments reasoned that Alex Jones is a 24/7 buffoon, so when someone from the mainstream, like Stelter, rises to the level of Jones's everyday buffoonery, then that's notable. Maybe we found a new measuring stick to go along with Reverend Al. If this is your first time watching one of our videos, or if you're already a fan, we usually release videos Mondays at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, unless like last week there's a holiday or something. So if you like what you're seeing, please give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. We're coming up on our next milestone of 200 subscribers, so please help us get to that goal. As always, our nominating committee had their hands full with potential buffoon nominees, and those that didn't quite make the cut still earn a shout-out as one of our dishonorable mentions. By now, you've probably heard about former Buffoon of the Week winner Joe Biden's "You Ain't Black" comment on radio, but as that news continued to reverberate this past week, the Biden gaffe machine kept right on rolling as he actually blamed radio host Charlemagne the God for goading him into making that comment.
He said, if you have a problem figuring out whether you're for me or for Trump, you ain't black.
Well,
now, you've since said that you shouldn't have been so cavalier. You said the NAACP has endorsed me every time I've run, which isn't true.
It was a mistake, number one. And I was smiling when he asked me the question. I was, I shouldn't have been such a wise guy with him. He was being a wise guy and I responded.
You know, nothing says complete buffoon quite like blaming someone else for your own mistakes. Speaking of past nominees, apparently MSNBC's Ali Velshi decided that the riots in Minneapolis was a good moment for him to start practicing some political gymnastics.
I want to be clear in how I characterize this. This is mostly a protest. It is not, generally speaking, unruly, but fires have been started.
Oh yeah. Nothing says peaceful protest quite like buildings ablaze. And how about this word jumble?
Was there were some police who went onto the roof of that building and fired tear gas canisters and noise guns, flashbangs, lights that make a lot of noise and
lights that make sounds. Ali certainly knows how to paint a picture with words, doesn't he? How about this for life imitating art? A tribe of monkeys in India attacked a lab assistant at a medical college and hospital and ran off with samples of blood from patients undergoing coronavirus treatment. I think I've seen this movie before.
In a remote African jungle, a small monkey is captured. Bound for a pet store in America, the animal carries a deadly virus.
Oh, but don't worry. We hear that the monkeys were just trying to help, as reports surfaced that the monkeys were merely delivering samples to Dr. Zayas, who was currently working on a coronavirus vaccine.
Ooh, help me, Dr. Zayas!
Dr. Zayas, Dr. Zayas! Dr. Zayas, Dr. Zayas! Dr. Zayas, Dr. Zayas! Oh, Dr. Zayas!
And finally, the financial world was rocked to find out that there may be one less billionaire in the world, as Forbes magazine claims that Kylie Jenner allegedly used bogus tax returns to earn its crown of the youngest ever self-made billionaire, a coveted title the Money magazine yanked this past Friday. Kylie Jenner then proceeded to post several messages on social media saying how much she did not care about what Forbes thinks, especially in this time of crises around the country. But that kind of made us think that maybe, just maybe, Kylie actually did care what they thought. But this week's nominees were head and shoulders above the pack as we pit social media giant Twitter against the two most recent bearers of the internet mantle, simply known as Karen. Last week wasn't exactly great for our first nominee, social media platform Twitter. Last Tuesday, Twitter appended fact-checking labels for the first time to two of President Donald Trump's tweets about mail-in balloting, rebutting the president's claim that mail-in ballots will lead to fraudulent ballots being cast in the 2020 election. This led to the president calling for a repeal of Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, which provides social media platforms protection from liability resulting from third-party postings. Trump has since signed an executive order calling for more scrutiny of companies like Twitter in the face of this fact-checking. News also broke that Twitter's, quote, head of site integrity, Yoel Roth, had a history of anti-Republican tweets himself. Roth had previously referred to Trump and his team as, quote, actual Nazis. He's mocked Trump supporters by saying, quote, we fly over those states that voted for a racist tangerine for a reason, and called Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell a personality-free bag of farts. Yep, tons of integrity coming from this guy right here. Maybe that's why it took a report from the New York Post for Twitter to agree to post similar fact checks on tweets from China made in March, spreading misinformation claiming that COVID-19 originated from the United States. You can imagine the backlash from Trump supporters to this apparent double standard. It got so bad that Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey had to intervene to tell everyone on Twitter to stop screwing with his employees. Which is so cute, considering Jack's employees screw with Twitter users on a daily basis. Like what you've seen so far? Don't forget to hit that thumbs up button. Leave us a comment as well, because we read every single one of them. And don't forget to subscribe so you never miss another episode of Buffoon of the Week. Our second nominee isn't a person necessarily, but it involves two women who made news this week that are representative of the internet archetype known as Karen. For those of you not hip to the lingo, a Karen is a person who is unhappy when little things don't go their way. They are a can I speak to your manager kind of gal. You know, the annoying soccer mom in her friend group that nobody actually likes. Or at least that's how it started. Karen has since grown from its humble beginnings as a meme profiling women based upon a ridiculous hairstyle into a political label for angry and entitled middle-aged women blowing very minor issues way out of proportion. Last week, there were two prime examples of women going full Karen. Never go full Karen, ladies. Karen number one is Amy Cooper, a New York woman who got into an argument with an African-American male in Central Park after he asked her something very simple. To leash your dog in a leash area. Cooper let her inner Karen loose, threatening to call the cops on the man and claiming that he, an African-American male, was threatening her.
Sir, I'm asking you to stop.
Please don't come close to me.
Sir, I'm asking you to stop recording me.
Please don't come close to me.
Please take your phone off.
Please don't come close to me.
And I'm taking a picture and calling the cops.
Please call the cops. Please call the cops.
I'm
going to
tell them there's an African-American man threatening my life.
Please tell them whatever you like.
As a result of the incident, Cooper has since been fired from her job and has had her dog taken away from her. Karen number two is only identified as parking lot Karen, who is seen standing in an open parking spot in a lot, holding that spot for someone else and blocking it from others using it. Even though, according to the person who made this video, there were two spots available. The video went viral on TikTok, amassing approximately 4.2 million likes, 18.2 million views, and over 85,000 comments in the first 4 days alone. See, folks, this is all I want. Just share our videos like you shared this one. No word yet as to whether Karen reached out to TikTok's manager to complain about the video. Hey, don't forget that Buffoon of the Week is all over social media, so when you're online, make sure you like us on Facebook, you follow us on the Twitters, and go on over to Instagram and like us there too. But the most important thing you have to do is remember to subscribe right here on YouTube. So with these two tough nominees to wrap your heads around, we can understand it if you need some aid in your deliberations, which is why we're going to run them through our trademark pending Sharpton scale of buffoonery. First, we are going to measure each nominee's buffoonish character by ranking them on a scale from 0 to 100 by comparing them to the only person known to have scored a perfect 100 on our scale, the Reverend Al Sharpton. We then quantify the buffoonish magnitude of each action using our custom unit of measurement, the Sharpton. Let's see what scientific breakthroughs we make this week. we're not going to wade into the political minefield of whether Twitter's actions merit removal of protections that the federal law provides. We're only going to ask one simple question. Why start your fact-checking with Trump? As the New York Post correctly pointed out, Twitter has allowed disinformation from bad actors like China and Iran to go on unchecked for years. So what made this tweet about ballot access the last straw? Twitter's choice of target and timing seems to be evidence of a hypocritical political agenda that many have felt Twitter has held for some years now. Twitter earns a score of 82, and its actions and subsequent duck and cover tactics score 3.71 gigasharptons. Analyzing the Karens of the world is a little bit hard. Their actions, in the grand scheme of things with COVID-19 and the riots in Minneapolis and all this political fallout, are pretty small in comparison. But Karen has a tendency to go viral often. So while the acts are normally small, it seems like everyone loves to call out a Karen, which means that their personal score is going to go up. That said, threatening to make a false police report is a bigger deal than your garden variety Karen move. So the Karens of the world will score a pretty high 85, but these particular actions get a higher than normal score of 2.52 gigasharptons. So one's a business, and the other's a concept, but they're both buffoons. But which is the bigger buffoon? It's time to vote, America. Tell us who you got for this week's Buffoon of the Week. Hey, so thanks again for watching the entire video. Be sure to give it a thumbs up if you haven't already. Share the video with all your friends that have the same sarcastic sense of humor that you have. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel. Because we're going to do it again next week where we have two more nominees, but only one can be Buffoon of the Week.